everybody. How are you? And welcome. Welcome to today's session. So good to have you here. My name is Naomi Judge. I'm a naturopath and clinical nutritionist. And today I'm going to be talking about the number one strategy to help you balance hormones. And I've been getting lots of questions, and I've been getting some questions specifically about certain hormones. So I'm going to touch on those, but I'm going to save those for a live, particularly for certain hormones. So I had a question about testosterone, balancing out testosterone. So today I am going to touch on that. I am going to help you, and we can talk about that a little bit. Also about lowering DHEA, and man, I am seeing it a lot that lots of women have elevated DHEA. DHEA is very much connected to your stress levels. Cortisol and DHEA kind of go hand in hand. And I'm finding that kind of early signs of adrenal fatigue, the DHEA can sometimes spike up. Now, it's good to have high DHEA in some circumstances. It's really protective, it's anti-cancer, it's a longevity hormone, it's anti-aging. But along with that, you also get some of the other side effects of high DHEA, like smelly body odor, acne on the back, hair growth, you know, the androgen kind of thing. So it's about balancing that out. But today I'm going to talk about this strategy, because with hormones, we all get different symptoms from elevated hormones. And I was telling a client the other day that, you know, some women who have elevated testosterone will get acne, but that doesn't mean that all women will get acne. And it's just like some women with very low progesterone will get fatigue or get infertility, but some women will feel fine. It's not everybody will experience exactly the same symptoms. And it's the same with where the hormone balance actually was triggered. For many of us, it can be completely different. And there are so many different things that can trigger hormone imbalances. Hey, Erin, so nice to see you. Welcome. I hope you're having a beautiful day. There are so many different things that can trigger hormone imbalances, you know, and there are so many different types of hormone imbalances. We've got estrogen dominance versus low progesterone. A small percentage of the population do have high progesterone. I'd say about 3% of my clients struggle with elevated progesterone. We've got low cortisol versus high cortisol. We've got low testosterone versus high testosterone. And so there is a variation. We've got insulin resistance, there's leptin resistance, low growth hormone, which I see quite often as well. So there are a variety of different hormone conditions, hormone imbalances, and they can be triggered by different things. Sometimes it can be post-traumatic stress. So sometimes an event in your life, you may have been going along quite fine, and then an event in your life that's traumatic, emotionally or physically, can just be it. That's the catalyst. That's the catalyst to send you out. That could be it. Maybe it's you've been struggling with it all your life. Maybe you were like me, and when I was a teenager, I was put on the contraceptive pill. I mean, that is terrible. That is terrible for a teenager to be put on the contraceptive pill, because synthetic hormones are so very bad. And I'm going to keep on. I know that it's done, and I know for some people they really need to go on them. But it's so bad for liver. It's so bad for the gallbladder. It's so bad for gut health, and it's just bad emotionally and mentally for these young teens. So for me, that's where it started. That's where everything started sort of going out of a balance. But for some, it can be post-traumatic stress. For some, it could be MTHFR, or simply having minerals out of balance. For others, it could be where you live and toxicity. Mold can also cause hormone imbalances. Your diet, high sugar, food intolerances, so eating wheat or eating dairy that you're sensitive to. So for so many of us, the triggers aren't always the same. What's a trigger for me might not be a trigger for you. And then please don't forget the emotional, spiritual kind of connection to hormones, and particularly to the ovaries and that kind of area, the sexual area for women, you know, the seat of our power, and where a lot of things can get disrupted, the energy can get stagnated. Whether you're not living the life that you want to live, that can have a huge impact. Whether you've had issues with a parent, whether you've been sexually abused, all these things will actually create this hormonal imbalance, and particularly around the ovaries and the uterus. We can get fibroids if we hold on to guilt, or hold on to shame, or don't forgive people, you know, forgiveness, all of just even those. So it may not be a physical thing like in your diet, but you can go the same route in terms of balancing it, and there are things that you can do separately, and there are things you can do for your hormones. But I find this one is the first place to start, the first thing that can get your hormones back on track. And that is balancing your macronutrients out. So once you start balancing your macronutrients out, that can help so much in balancing your hormones, and for so many different reasons for different people. So when I talk about balancing your macronutrients, I'm talking about balancing your fats, balancing your carbohydrates, which are your starches, balancing your proteins, and then chucking in lots and lots of vegetables. Because once you get your meal created, once you get your macronutrients right for you, that will start to balance out your leptin levels, it will start to balance out your insulin levels, your glucose levels, and this is what has a knock-on effect to your other hormones. If you can get your blood sugar regulated, that will help balance your testosterone. If you can get your leptin regulated, that will help balance your estrogen. If you're giving your body the right nutrition, the right balance of macronutrients, that will help to raise progesterone. Now, I know there's tons of diets out there, like the 5-2 diet, the ketogenic diet, the paleo diet, the high fat diet, all sorts of diets, fasting, all those diets, and they can work really well therapeutically. They're wonderful therapeutic diets. But the place to start first when you want to balance your hormones is such a simple place, and it's simply just balancing your macronutrients and knowing what works for you. Now, certain macronutrients have certain effects on different hormones, and this is why you need to know a little bit more about what your hormones are doing. You know, look at your symptoms, look at your body signs to give you an indication whether you have high testosterone, whether you have high estrogen, whether you have issues with progesterone, because then that will give you a bit more of indication of the foods you can start to include more of and the foods you should really say no to. So I give you some examples before we move into macronutrients, because we'll drill down a little bit more. So for instance, with testosterone, your yang hormone, your androgen, a hormone for muscle mass, a hormone for vitality, like libido, I'm finding a lot of women actually have very high testosterone. Now, one of the foods, one of the macronutrients that can cause your testosterone to elevate can be having too much fat. So the more fat you have in your diet, particularly coconut oil, can trigger the synthesis of more testosterone. So it's great if you've got low testosterone. It's great that ketogenic diet is fantastic. Fantastic if you really low in your hormones, really low in your androgens. A ketogenic diet is great in postmenopausal. Ketogenic diet is fantastic for men that are balding, because you know men are balding, and it's not because of testosterone, it's not because of DHT, it's because men have high estrogen. That's why they're going prematurely bald, and that's the whole thing there. So a ketogenic diet can really help men that are going bald. So it can be fantastic. But if you've got polycystic ovarian syndrome and your testosterone is through the roof, then you having more fat, and especially coconut oil, will actually do you a bit of a disservice. So what then you need to do is you need to work on lowering that and maybe increasing another macronutrient, like actually increasing carbohydrates. And some women do so much better on higher carbohydrates. So it's about working it out for you and knowing what to do. For estrogen, for example, you know, if you're having lots of soy in your diet or lots of gluten, wheat in your diet, that can actually cause more estrogen dominance. That will exacerbate endometriosis, that will exacerbate fibroids, exacerbate ovarian cysts. So definitely taking out those inflammatory foods, those foods you're sensitive to, that will help to bring down and balance out your estrogen levels. Cortisol, for example, if you've got cortisol that is through the roof, really high cortisol, and you're wired all the time and all that kind of, you know, high cortisol, you're not sleeping, you might do better from a vegetarian diet for a while. You know, very, very high cortisol, you might do better from having more potassium type foods, more vegetables, more non-gluten grains for a little bit of time, just to kind of bring that down and to get your parasympathetic nervous system from sympathetic into parasympathetic. So that's kind of switching it over, and you'll find you'll get more results there. However, if you're really fatigued and you've got super, super low cortisol and you're feeling really worn out, then what you'll probably need to do is actually include more sodium in your diet, more protein, more animal products in your diet to bring that cortisol up. So there are things you can do individually for your hormones to help support them, balance them, bring them up, bring them down, whatever you need to do. But as a general rule, to start balancing out your hormones, mind, you need to start here, and that is balancing out your macronutrients. So starting with breakfast, then going on to lunch, then going on to dinner, and balancing out those three meals and trying not to snack if that's possible. So for example, balancing out your macronutrients means identifying the best macronutrients for you, whether you're vegan, whether you eat meat, whether you're paleo, whether you're vegetarian, whatever it is you eat, you've got to identify and bucket out those macronutrients. So my advice to you is actually sit down and write out a list of the macronutrients that you can eat, that are your favorite, that are easy for you to get, easy for you to eat, and then you can go from there. So what you can do, hi Catherine, how are you? What are you laughing at? I thought maybe the cat was doing something funny in the background. So what you need to do first is work out what macronutrients do for you. So my suggestion is, and this is a really, I'm going to just help you through this, because once you get this sorted out, it helps you. It's not stressful anymore. You know what to buy at the supermarket, you know what to buy at the shops. So write the columns out. So you need four columns. Even though there's kind of three macronutrients, I count vegetables and macronutrients. So write your columns out. You've got your proteins, you've got your starches. Oh, okay. I thought something was happening behind me. I thought, oh, what's the cat doing? My little doody over there. I thought she was doing something funny, but she's sleeping. Bless her. Oh, she's so tired. Tired all the time. So write out the columns. You've got your proteins. You've got your starches, which are your carbs. You've got your fats. And then you've got your vegetables, your non-starchy vegetables. And start with what's your favorite. So start with the ones that are your favorite. So if you eat meat in your protein section, you might have lamb, you might have chicken, you might have white fish, you might have prawns, you might have oysters. So just write out everything you know that's easy for you to get, easy for you to cook, and you know that you'll enjoy eating. So you've got your proteins. If you're a vegan or vegetarian, it does make it harder, because the problem with your proteins is they kind of mingle over into carbs and starches. So if you're trying to lose weight, you need to be really careful with the proteins that you eat. So as a vegetarian or vegan, you would put the foods with the highest protein at the top. So the foods with the highest protein that are vegan and vegetarian would be your pumpkin seeds, would be your nuts and seeds, would then go down to things like quinoa, would be buckwheat and legumes. Remember that they're all very high. They're about 40% starch. So the starch in quinoa and legumes is around the same starch that's in your basmati rice. Only difference being is they've got a few more nutrients, some more fiber, and more protein. So you would go with those if you were vegan and vegetarian. So write down all the proteins you know you love and you know you can eat. Then write down kind of the starches which you know are good for you and you know you can eat. Now the favorite starches you could eat would be your starches like pumpkin, sweet potato, quinoa is a starch, legumes are a starch, squash is a starch, basmati rice is a starch. So all the ones that you know you eat, you know you would love. So write those out. Then you've got fats. Now again, you know, fats, there are a lot of different fats, but the ones you want to stay away from would be your hydrogenated fats and things like canola oil. So what you'd like to start with is have a look at your, you know, non-dairy fats. You've got your raw olive oil, you've got your macadamia nut oil, you've got your avocado oil. Oh, Lisa, yum, what are you having for lunch? I'm hungry. I started this a bit late because I lost my phone, but it actually happened to be in my bag. I had to actually find my iPhone, and then I heard my bag, but I'm a bit hungry. I can't wait for lunch after this. So writing down your favorite fats, and olive oil, avocado oil, and then butter, ghee, lard can be something, you know, rendered duck fat, whatever, all those fats. So anything like that, avocado, olives, macadamias are high fat, and then coconut oil, coconut products. So you can see how now you're getting a list of a variety of different macronutrients to give you some ideas of how to use these. And then just write down all the veg. Now, if you're high estrogen or estrogen dominant, vegetables are the most important thing. Now, particularly if you're a meat eater. Now, if you're a vegetarian, you're probably eating a lot of veg. And my issue when I was a vegetarian was I was eating too much vegetables and fiber. So I was actually losing nutrition because I was going to the bathroom a lot, like it was good and I was cleansing. But as a vegetarian, I was kind of in a yin state. I was in a low mineral state because I was eating too much fiber, too many vegetables. It wasn't giving me enough chance to actually hold on to my nutrients. So it's about balancing that out. But particularly if you're a meat eater, you need to be having 6+ cups of vegetables a day. So you write out all your favorite vegetables and your different vegetables. You want raw vegetables, you want cooked vegetables. So all your brassica vegetables are great if you're estrogen dominant. You know, you want to be having your broccoli, your cabbage, your onion, your kale, your cauliflower. All those foods are wonderful if you're estrogen dominant. And then of course, if you find you can't tolerate them, I've mentioned this before with those foods, you can make them into soups, cook them up really well and blend them, and then you might tolerate them a bit more. So now you've got a list of all these cool foods, you know, and foods that maybe you didn't know were that macronutrient. For instance, fat. Maybe you didn't realize that macadamias were the highest fat. Maybe you didn't realize that cashew nuts were actually the highest carbohydrate. So cashew nuts can go into starch, macadamias can go into fat, almonds and Brazil nuts can go into protein as well, with chia seeds and your pumpkin seeds can all go into protein. Pine nuts are nice and fatty, so they can go into fat. So now you've got this really beautiful comprehensive list of foods that you love, maybe even some foods that you didn't even think about. So now you can start combining. So for example, if tomorrow you were cooking yourself a quinoa salad, in the quinoa salad, what do people normally put in quinoa salads? What do you see all the time? People normally put pumpkin and quinoa salad together. That's kind of crazy because then you kind of like got double starch, and we don't double dip on starches in meals. So that's a trick, not double dipping on starches in meals. So in the quinoa salad, instead of having, say, sweet potato or pumpkin, you say, okay, what do I need here? Non-starchy vegetables. So non-starchy vegetables would go in the quinoa salad. We might do salad-y vegetables. So we might do capsicum. We might do cucumber. So a couple of cups of non-starchy vegetables. So you've got your quinoa as a base, then you've got your non-starchy vegetables, and you remember to yourself, I don't double dip on starches. So we don't go two starch. We never go two starch. It's just one starch. So it's either quinoa, legumes, or sweet potato that you're having, but you're no double dipping. So you've got your quinoa salad, you've got your non-starchy vegetables, and then you think to yourself, well, I do need maybe a little bit of fat. So what could you add? You could add some olives, you could add a drizzle of olive oil, or maybe you could add some pumpkin seeds into there. And if you wanted to go higher protein and you were a meat eater, what you could do is you could add some chicken into there. And so you see how you kind of layer the macronutrients to help support your metabolism. It's going to help support your blood sugar, and it's also going to be the foods that you're used to eating as well. So it kind of makes it easier. But that's how you would build your meal, and that's how you would create a meal. So another example would be, say, for dinner. Say I'll do a dinner example. So if you were just going to have your meat and three veg, some people might do... say, you know, white fish, and then they might do like roast potato, carrots, pumpkin, that kind of thing. And so you can see how you then got protein and you just got a ton of starch. Whereas what you need to have is you need to have your protein, and then you need to say, what non-starchy vegetables will I have? So you might do zucchini, and then you might do green beans, and say I want a little bit of starch, so then you might do some roast sweet potato. So balancing out your macronutrients is so important because we get it so wrong. We get it so wrong all the time. Pumpkin soup is an example. Pumpkin soup, you know, is a very high starch meal. And what you need to put in pumpkin soup is you either need to put fat in it, or you need to make it with broth, so it's high in protein. So you need to just work out how to create these meals and these macronutrients to suit yourself. Let's talk about breakfast quickly. I'd like to touch on breakfast. Let's imagine you're having some porridge or something like that. You might have some oats. Now oats, they're high starch oats. So what we want to do is we want to kind of buffer them out, and we want to create a meal for breakfast that's going to sustain us. It's going to balance out our leptin levels so we're not hungry. It's going to support our blood sugar levels so our glucose doesn't spike and our insulin doesn't spike, and that causes inflammation and that makes us hungry in a couple of hours. So if you're having porridge, You don't want to just have oats and water because then we've just got starch. You could do oats with coconut milk because then we've got the starch with the fat. Or what you could do is you can layer out your muesli, layer out your oats so that you're adding more consistent proteins in there. You could do your oats, overnight oats. You could add some coconut shreds. You could add some pumpkin seeds. You could add some chia seeds. You could add some almonds. And then you're creating this meal that's going to sustain you, and that's what is going to balance your hormones. Hi, Natalie. How can you recommend chicken or meat in a balancing out your hormones video? All animal products completely throw out your hormones due to their toxicity. So not always. So with hormones, the first place you want to start is balancing out your blood sugar. Now with someone that's got really bad blood sugar, they can actually do better having animal products. So it can help. They won't always. And what you want to do is, it's about having minimal and it's about having quality. So with animal products, definitely not having animals that are raised in intensive farming, definitely not having non-organic, not having chickens that are non-organic, not having meats that are not grass-fed. So definitely not doing that. But for some people, it can help. So we're all so very different. Some people, a vegetarian diet and a vegan diet suits them so well. And for others, it doesn't work as well. And most of them are toxic. A lot of them are toxic, depending on how they've been farmed. But you can get grass-fed, grass-grazed. You can get good quality, but it's about that. So definitely, eating meat every day from bad sources can be really bad for your hormones, and it can throw them out because it can lead to liver toxicity. Gallbladder can have problems. So definitely, it can be difficult, yes. So agree with you in certain, agree with you a little bit there, but it can be good for some people, definitely. Okay, so we've talked about testosterone, and actually animal products, if you've got elevated testosterone, can put testosterone up. So if you were somebody that had polycystic ovarian syndrome, or if you were somebody that had high testosterone, bringing more animal products into your body can elevate the testosterone. But if you're somebody that has low growth hormone, that has insulin resistance, that has problems with blood sugar, then it can help to balance it out. So just know what your hormones are doing. And definitely if you have liver problems, you want to go more a veggie diet. So you want to go more on the vegetables side of things, so it can help to balance out those toxicity, and it can help to cleanse your liver. So it's all about adding all those in. Hi Catherine, seen that in my family, my brother has been vegan and veg, but has found best health being a flexitarian. Yeah, look, it's a really interesting one, Catherine. It's one, I mean, I definitely look at it a lot. I was vegetarian from the age of 8, and I was vegetarian from 8 till 28, 29, 30, kind of strict vegetarian. I'd never had any fish. I'd never had a steak. I'd had a bit of lamb before the age of 8 that mum cooked. I know, like lunch, you know, Sunday lunch lamb. I just never liked meat, and it suited me for a bit. But the problem I found was because I was so strict, and at a young age, I was an unhealthy vegetarian, so I used to eat a lot of carbohydrates, I used to eat a lot of pasta. I didn't do it correctly. And then through my 20s, because I had some hormonal issues, it just didn't suit me. So I've kind of been a bit more flexi, and what I'm doing now does suit me a little bit more. So what I used to find when I was vegan and vegetarian, I used to find I was a little bit cold. I used to find I'd get tired easily through the day. I used to find I was more of a grazer. And so being a little bit more flexy about it is good. And sometimes, you know, I just need a little bit. So I prefer a veggie diet. I prefer vegetable soups. I mean, I love vegetables. I love vegetable soups. You know, I'll eat legumes. Legumes suit me. I'm fine with that. Dal and things like that. But I do need, and I do like to have for my constitution, some animal products in my diet. I like to be flexible about it. And but some people thrive on a vegan diet. Some people thrive on a vegetarian diet. I actually did, you know, I've experimented since coming away from being a vegetarian. I have experimented with a few diets, and it's interesting to see the effects they have on your diet. So an example is I did a high protein diet for a little while and sort of got addicted to the protein, addicted to the animal protein. And what was funny that sent me into quite a hot yang state. So, you know, I was quite wired all the time, heart palpitations, quite a little bit anxious. And so it sent me too much, too high. And it was funny doing that. That was on kind of like a semi-paleo, ketogenic kind of diet. It was just too much. Yeah, I think that's the thing. I think for balance, and I do think that we can have a sustainable environment if we all do that. We all try and do the balance, either grow or farming our own foods. If that's not possible in the city, having just going more towards the vegetables and then bringing in some foods when we need. And we don't need as much protein and we don't need as much animal products as a lot of people would have us believe. You know, I think paleo can suit some, but sometimes with a paleo diet I see too much animal products and not enough vegetables. And this is a thing with any diet, vegetables are the key. So when you're balancing out your macronutrients, you want to have about 50% of your plate being vegetables. And I think that's the key, and I think that's where a lot of people miss out. They don't have all those vegetables. They might have the meat. They might even have a little, you see, meat and some fat. People have fat on their plate, and maybe they've just got a tiny bit of vegetable. But you want about 50% vegetables on your plate, and just keep, because those vegetables, they're going to help support the bowel. They have antioxidants, anti-aging. They help support your liver and your gallbladder. And so those are really what's giving us the life and detoxifying our body. And the other things are just giving us sort of key nutrients that we need for DNA, for cell turnover, regeneration, growth, brain cells, that kind of thing. So I hope that helped. I'd love to know, you know, what you find works for you. You know, if you're vegetarian, vegan, and you find that works beautifully for you, then that's fine. And I think we're all very different, and it's different diets suit different people. And so it's just understanding that, understanding what suits you, and to get the most out of your food, to balance your hormones, because once you do that, then, and everything's working, you're like your liver and your bowel, then that's where you can balance your hormones, and that's kind of where the magic happens. So I hope that helped. Thank you so much for joining in today. Thank you for so much for your comments. I'd love to hear though back from you about what macronutrients, what combinations work for you, and how you found balancing out your combinations or changing your meal has actually changed your hormones and you've actually benefited from it. So I'd love to hear that. Yeah, so exactly. So this is a comment you hear all the time, and this is one of the things when people are vegan and vegetarian, it really does change. It can change the energy in them. And I know when I was vegan, vegetarian, I was quite different from what I am now, and I would say I did feel more in touch. I still feel more in touch with nature. I'm quite empathetic in terms of nature, but it does definitely bring a calmness, eating more vegetables and not relying on the kind of the yang from animal products. So there's a lot to be said for that. And that definitely goes, if you are a meat eater, I would encourage you to either reduce your meat intake, you know, for better quality, or at the very least, you know, have a veggie meal once or twice, a veggie day once or twice a week. So you're giving your body a break as well. You're giving your body a break from actually digesting those amino acids that's in protein, because that uses up a lot of nutrition, that uses up a lot of B vitamins. So at least if you are a meat eater, you know, having those days off, you can balance your hormones and be eating meat or be a vegan vegetarian. You just got to do it in a clever way. So thanks so much for joining. Hope you all had enjoyed that, got a lot out of that. And I'll see you next week. Bye.